In this video, we're going to be taking a look at how we can use information from the normal probability distribution to calculate probabilities when they're not associated with an exact number of standard deviations. So in other words, when we can't use the empirical rule directly, how can we come up with probabilities for areas under the standard normal curve? And so specifically, what we're going to be looking at is something called standard units and areas under the standard normal curve. So the standard unit that is being referred to is something called the z-score. And there's a very straightforward formula for calculating it. Z is equal to x minus mu over sigma. And this is something that would only get utilized with a normal curve. Z is just what we call the standard unit. We label it with the letter Z. X here is an actual raw data value. Mu is the mean of the normal distribution that you're dealing with, and sigma is the standard deviation of the normal distribution that you're dealing with. And basically, we will be taking a normal curve. Every single normal curve with a different mu and sigma combination results in a different normal curve. And when we make this conversion from the original raw data values to these z-scores, what you will find out is that just by that unit conversion, every single normal curve boils down into one normal curve that's called the standard normal curve, just by virtue of making this conversion from raw data values to the standard unit of z-scores. So let's go back to our example that we were talking about with IQ. And let's look at the distribution for the raw data values. So these would be the data that you actually would collect. Now, when we talked about IQ, we said the IQ had a mean of 100. So this normal curve would be centered at 100. And it had a standard deviation of 15. So this was 115, 130, 145. This was 100 minus 15 is 85. And then 70, and then 55. Okay, so that was the raw data. Now, when we make this conversion from raw data values to the standard z-score unit, for each of these values in here, every single raw data value will have a z-score associated with it. And to find that, we take the raw data value, subtract the mean of the distribution, and divide by the standard deviation. So let's go ahead and give that a try and see what comes out. If I start with the value of 55, I would take 55 and subtract the mean of 100. And when we do that, 55 minus 100 gives us negative 45. So that would be this part here. 55 minus 100 gives us negative 45. Divide by the standard deviation of 15. So negative 45 divided by 15 gives us a value of negative 3. So after this unit conversion, the piece that was 55 is now negative 3. We would do the same thing for the 70. 70 minus the mean of 100 would be negative 30. Divide by 15, which is the standard deviation, we would get negative 2. 85 minus 100 would be negative 15. Divide by the standard deviation of 15, we get negative 1. 100 minus the mean of 100 would be 0. Divide by the standard deviation of 15 is still 0. And then we'll see kind of the same pattern being symmetric on the other side. This time when we take our raw data value of 115 and subtract the mean of 100, we'll get a positive 15. divide by the standard deviation of 15, positive 1. Then 130 minus 100 would be 30, divide by 15, 2. 145 minus 100 is 45, divide by 15, 3. Okay. This is what it looks like in terms of standard scores. And regardless of what your mean and standard deviation of your raw data were, once you make this conversion into z-scores, every single normal curve boils down to this one. That's why it's called the standard normal curve. It is centered at 0, and one standard deviation above the mean is represented by a positive 1. One standard deviation below the mean is represented by negative 1. Similarly, two standard deviations on either side of the mean are designated with positive 2 and negative 2. Three standard deviations on either side of the mean, positive 3 and negative 3. What z-scores tell you, what those values are actually telling you, is how many standard deviations, either above or below the mean, that you're looking at. And all of the stuff from the empirical rule still applies. We had 68% of our IQ data between 85 and 115. We still have 68% of our data between negative 1 and 1, and 95% between negative 2 and 2, and 99.7% between negative 3 and 3. It's just a different unit system and a different way of looking at the normal curve, so that it all boils down to this one single curve. Now what we're going to do with this is we're going to, anytime we encounter a problem where we're coming up with probabilities for standard normal curves, we will convert to the z-scores or the standard scores first, and then there is a program in our calculator that will allow us to find the area under the standard normal curve between any two endpoints, regardless of whether those endpoints are nice whole number values or if they're, you know, decimal values like negative 2.75 and 1.08 and that kind of stuff. So let me demonstrate for you how to do that. Let's say that we wanted to, here's an example, we want to sketch the area under the standard normal curve and find the area between, let's say, z is equal to negative 0.95 and z is equal to 1.33. Okay, so that's what I want to find. Excuse me. So first we'll do the sketching piece. There's our normal curve. Centered at 0, negative 1, 1, 2. Okay, negative 0.95 is going to be almost out to the negative 1. It's going to be pretty close. 1.33 will be a little bit above the 1. And so here's our sketch. Okay, we wanted to sketch the area between those two endpoints under the standard normal curve. There's the area we're looking for. Now we also want to find that area. What percentage is this? Well, one way we could do this would be to get an estimate using the using the empirical rule. There we go. Sorry, my brain blanked out on me for a second. We can get a rough estimate, but we can't get an exact value. Now, if we were to have gone just from negative 1 to 1, that would be 68%. But we didn't go all the way out to negative 1 here, and we went a little bit beyond 1 here. If we were to go from negative 1 all the way up to the positive 2, that would be the 68% that's in here, plus the 13.5% that's between 1 and 2. And if you look at that, that would be 81.5% if we went from negative 1 all the way to positive 2. But we didn't go all that way. We went in a little bit on both sides. So we're expecting this to come in at over 68% probably, but less than 81.5% is what we're thinking. So, or it could be pretty close to 68%. Let's see what happens when we put this into the calculator. So where we're going to put this into the calculator is into a formula called, or into a program, called normal CDF, very similar to what we did with the binomial PDF and CDF, but we're going to be dealing with normal CDF, cumulative density function, because we want an area under a big range of the normal curve. And your calculator is going to want two inputs here. It's going to want to know the leftmost boundary value of your interval, or the lowest value. So that's a -0.95. Then it'll want a comma and the upper boundary value, 1.33. If you have the new operating system, you'll get a slightly different screen here. It'll ask you for the lower, the upper, the mu, and the sigma. Lower will be -0.95. Upper will be 1.33, and then because we're dealing with the standard normal curve, the mu is 0, and the sigma should be set to 1. So that's what it would be like with the new OS. With the old OS, let me show you what the screen would look like. And you find them both the same way. So you go to second, vars, your distributions menu, and then normal CDF is your very second option here. Normal PDF is first, normal CDF is second. So we'll select normal CDF. Again, if you have the new OS at this point, you'll have a different screen that pops up. But our low value is -0.95, comma, our high value is 1.33. Close out the parenthesis, press enter, and we find that we get 0.74, roughly 74%, which seems totally reasonable. That's above our 68% and below the 80%. Whatever it was I said, that we were expecting it to come in underneath. Okay, that seems perfectly reasonable based on the sketch that we have. So that's one example of how to use this formula in your calculator. Now, one thing that might come up, excuse me, is if you're dealing with infinite endpoints. So let's say I wanted to find the probability, capital P, of a z-score being less than or equal to 1.20. Okay, let's say that's what I was interested in. Well, when I draw my sketch here, 0, 1, 2, 1.20 is going to be right about in here, and then I'm going to shade all the way to the left. Now, technically, this distribution goes all the way to negative infinity on the left, but if you try and put into your calculator normal CDF negative infinity, comma 1.20. Your calculator gets a little angry about that. So we need to use something other than infinity there to represent that infinite left endpoint. And there are a lot of numbers that you could use, but since 3 in terms of units of standard deviation is considered to be a pretty big number, we have very little data past, you know, negative 3, negative 100 might as well be infinity. As far as standard units are concerned. Certainly you could use any sufficiently large value. You could use negative 500, you could use negative 1000, negative 250, but negative 100 tends to be really convenient. So since we're going all the way to the left, we're starting at that infinite negative value, so negative 100, comma, we're going up to the 1.20, and we would close out that parentheses. And when we do that on the calculator, pick our normal CDF and do negative 100, 1.20, what we find is that we have about 88% under the standard normal curve. Okay. Now certainly, again, we could check this out. From the midpoint all the way to the left, that would be 50%. Between here and here, we know that's another 34%, so that would be 84, and we've gone a little bit past that. And we can see we're coming in at 88. So that seems perfectly reasonable. Now what we're going to look at in the next video is we're going to take a look at what happens when, first of all, we don't have z-scores already given to us. So we'll actually have to convert raw data values into z-scores before using normal CDF. And also we're going to throw some context on top of here. What if I was doing an application type problem or word problem? How would I do that? With the normal CDF. And we'll also have a video where we take a look at guarantee problems as well.